So what I research is I look at the effect of cigarette smoke on the immune system. And in there, it's relevant to COPD because COPD is a smoking-related disease. By and large, I don't specifically focus on COPD. It's more a larger area where I look at the effect on cigarette smoke. And the problem is that if you actually look at public awareness of COPD, then it's only about 14% of the general population that knows what COPD is, which is a bit at variance or at odds to the actual prevalence, where COPD is projected to be the third killer by 2030 now. The number for 2020 was probably the fourth killer. So it's actually a fairly, it is a health problem. It's a fairly big health problem. And it is a problem that a lot of people don't know about. The field is not that large at this point in time. It's a big health problem, but it's not as much research in it as there should be in it. And in that respect, it should, if anything, it should grow. It should get larger. The part that is interesting about COPD research is that Canada is actually doing quite well, because some of the key proponents in that field are in Canada. And who comes to mind there would be Jim Hogg. Jim Hogg is one of the pioneers in that field. The lack of funding and the lack of public awareness, and probably to some extent the denial of the patients that do have COPD, because they would often resort to, it's a self-inflicted disease, it's my own fault, not acknowledging that smoking at the end of the day is an addiction. People do smoke, it is an addiction, so from that end we need to know disease pathways. At this point in time, getting funding is not easy, period. And it really doesn't matter in what area you're researching. Is it now more difficult for COPD than for other diseases? And in there, the answer is probably yes, because there is the notion of it being a preventable disease, it being a smoker's disease. And anti-smoking campaigns have done an excellent job at marginalizing smokers. Cessation is critical. Preventing people to start smoking is critical. But at the same token, we have a large patient population where we need to know what are the mechanisms that contribute to the disease. On top of that, another issue is smoking-related diseases. There's a strong socio-economic component to it, that the prevalence is higher in lower socio-economic levels. So from that end, you don't have a rich, affluent patient population. Oftentimes you have a not very well educated patient population. So from a fundraising perspective, you're facing a little bit of an uphill battle. Being turned down? Not necessarily. Having said that, the flip side of the coin is that for other diseases, there are very strong funding agencies. And in there, what comes to mind is the cancer funding agencies, the heart and stroke, diabetes. There's a number of very strong organizations. What's interesting in there is that if you look at cancer, a high proportion of cancers are related to smoking. So funding should actually go towards smoking-related cancer. In there we have lung cancer. Lung cancer is now killing more people than prostate and breast cancer combined. So it is the number one killer. If you look at the amount of funding that is going into lung cancer, the then it's disproportionate. I think more researchers have to get involved into this kind of research, and then the funding will, there will be more funding going into COPD research, as opposed to a top to bottom where you basically say we gotta allocate specific funding. You also have to have the pool of researchers that go into that direction. Struggles and barriers of COPD research, right? It comes down to chronic diseases in general. Well, I think that's where one of the fundamental issues lies, in that chronic diseases are often not clearly defined diseases. They're more like syndrome. So you're actually dealing with a very broad patient heterogeneity, where one COPD patient is not the same like the next one. So one of the challenges, one of the struggles is the patient heterogeneity. The other problem is that COPD is not a disease that develops overnight. It's a disease secondary to years and years and years of smoking. So these are slow developing diseases. So in there, to research a slow developing disease has its own logistical problems. If you do research or aspire to research and you take tobacco funding, then by and large you're banned from any activities of the American Thoracic Society, of the European Thoracic Society, the list goes on. Which the ban means a ban in presenting at the meetings, a ban in publishing in the papers. So it's a very real and it's a very real thing. But ultimately there was a lot of denial, there was a lot of trying to bias research. So there's a history there. So tobacco companies have done things they shouldn't have done. At one point the program that was at arm's length, there still was, first of all, the perception of it's still tobacco, and the reality that it could still be abused. So should research not be able to obtain any tobacco funding, I think it will have to be revisited. It has to be revisited very carefully. At the end of the day, if done properly, if monitored properly, if it really is in support of the patient population and in the support of developing new knowledge how those diseases develop, then I would think it should be okay. But it has to be truly at arm's length. And at the end of the day, it has to be accompanied as well by attempts to prevent people from starting to smoke and attempts for cessation as well. So it has to be a concerted effort. But it's a very hot topic and there is no simple answer.